When I was living in England after I went to this school, and I didn't want to leave. I loved England so much. I just thought, well, I have to become, this is before they had acting schools, like NYU grad acting, which we can't stop plugging enough, where Clayton went and where I saw all of your performers. We'll get to that in a minute. We got a long show here today, ladies and gentlemen. There's a whole epic going on here of Clayton's history at NYU. But I went to London and auditioned for all the drama schools, and I even had this teacher who, you know, because there was, I could, this little old lady who was a Shakespearean, you know, coach, and she wanted me to do Cardinal Wolsey's speech at age 22 from Henry VIII. Now, that for sure was Shakespeare. I've reached the highest point of all my greatness. Obviously, this is it today with Clayton Apgar here at the CSC Rep.
I don't think that's...
Oh, well, I mean, but we know Shakespeare. You could just sense the power in that speech. And I sense that in your scene and in the scenes we've just been mentioning with Mackenzie and Slate.
Slate.
His name, his first name is Slate?
Slate Holmgren, yeah.
Okay, that's a name we'll all remember,
right?
And he went to Yale. He went to Yale. Okay,
right. He went to Yale. Well, I think that's a fascinating point. So what makes it Shakespeare? What makes something Shakespeare
for us? The power.
So there's the poetry. You could get the emotional connection too. Yeah, certainly the language. Part of what has convinced scholars now that Double Falsehood is Shakespeare and Fletcher, or at least still has the ghost of Shakespeare, as we said during rehearsal.
A haunted text.
Mm-hmm. That he is throughout, that at some point early on, that they were the first authors of it, is that they've done computer modeling, where they actually map the language, which hasn't been available up until recently. So there are key words that are words that Shakespeare used, or words that Fletcher used, or words that neither used. So they feel like now they can get very specific with this part seems like it's probably Shakespeare, and this is probably Fletcher, because there are essentially computer models using the mathematics of language, phrasing, writing. A forger just wouldn't have been able to identify that he was using Shakespearean speech or textual patterns, essentially, or those of Fletcher. Fascinating.
But you spoke this language like a totally natural, as if you had been trained all your life as a Shakespearean actor. And as a matter of fact, you were, because you went to NYU grad, and so did Mackenzie,
right.
Is that her name?
And so did Bryce Gill.
And Bryce
who was also
is fabulous.
Show.
Bryce coming out of nowhere.
Well, I think Brian director.
Or out of Al Pacino's Merchant, excuse me. hardly nowhere. And NYU grad, yes.
Talk
about Brian, yeah.
Well, because nobody knows this play, because it's coming to see Shakespeare for the first time.
It's so
which
exciting.
Never happens.
Never.
This might be the last time it happens for another 250 years. The audience doesn't know it, so they're depending on us a lot to very clearly tell a story.
Right.
With verse that they're not accustomed to hearing every day.
How did you audition for this? Did you audition with the Shakespearean monologues or something like that?
We used scenes from...
The play.
From the play, right, and we worked with Brian. He does them in here, actually. It's always nice to do an audition, actually, in a theater. And
this
he's great
a nice
with working...
Space. It's really nice sitting
It feels
here.
Good. It feels...
Actor-friendly,
intimate. You're right there with the audience, and especially for a piece like this, you need that. So our single greatest responsibility we feel as a company is to clearly tell the story, because it's a convoluted story with holes, because some of the material has been lost over intervening years. So at the very least, we should be doing that, which means. Learning the language, knowing what we're saying on every single line, and then trying to convey it in an honest, emotional, clear way.
Which you
so
do.
If we're doing that,
which
then.
You really do, especially in that mad scene. And there was a kind of sort of reportorial thing going on through most of the play, just sort of like exposition. Mm-hmm. But then when you hit those big emotional scenes, I say, oh, well, that's Shakespeare for sure. Mm. That is Shakespeare-like. And there wasn't, in Henry VIII, which is the play that set the globe on fire, burnt it down, when you get to those speeches like Catherine of Aragon's or Cardinal Wolsey's, they just jump out at you again. And Pericles, which I also studied at Stratford-upon-Avon. Another play that Pericles is not Shakespeare much at all.
Yeah.
But they included it. And this is sort of like Pericles-like in that it's got all these problems. But so before we actually run out of time, oh my God, you graduated from NYU and you come from Maryland, I think, mm-hmm. Baltimore, is that right?
Yeah, DC and then Baltimore.
I thought you had a background that your family was all lawyers, but you said I was wrong about that. You were thinking about political science or some other career.
I majored in history.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't start acting until the end of college. I was writing my history thesis.
Right.
The consolidation of New York City. I was writing a narrative of it, and I wanted an easy, fun course to do while I was doing that. So one of my two courses senior spring in college was Intro to Scene Study 201 with Davis McCallum, and I got hooked. So I naively moved to New York to become an actor.
Before you got into knowing
what that meant. And I spent 2 years bouncing around the city with my backstage subscription, sending out the headshots and resumes every week.
Yeah.
And then found my way to some mentors who then turned me on to NYU. And then that worked out from there.
What was your favorite part at NYU?
It was Michael in Dancing at Lunasa, the narrator.
Oh,
of
which
Dancing at
I
Lunasa.
Don't. I saw that. Yes, with the
a bit of a raked stage.
Yeah, and the wall. It was a rock wall, I think, between the audience. Wasn't there?
Yes, it was. It was the bottom half of the house, essentially. It was like the house was cut off.
No, I remember you in that. You
were
in a white suit.
It was my. It wasn't a white suit, but it was. Yeah, it was a gray suit.
A gray suit.
It was the first time I was introduced really to Irish writing, Irish writers, whom
well,
I
I'm
love.
One. I'm one. You knew me.
Right. Well, I didn't know you yet. At
oh,
that point. You're
okay.
Right. We were just starting to.
To get to know
since
each
I've
other.
Become such an admirer.
Well, and moi aussi, monsieur. And then you've had a series of very literary kind of confrontations with other writers, like, for instance, this play of Thornton Wilder's, which I'd never seen, the name of which
right.
was...
Such Things Only Happen in Books, which was one of the names of the...
Which you were great
the
in.
Short plays. Thank you.
It was a series of short plays by Thornton Wilder.
Mm-hmm. Some of which had never been done before. The Thornton Wilder estate then agreed to let Keene Company do it. And
That's right.
It was a great experience because I got to know a lot of other Thornton Wilder's work, and he's just such a beautiful writer. And then read some of his novels too, which I didn't know existed. And he's just
I met his sister,
really,
who was like in her 90s in a nursing home. That was a moment. Let me tell you, her name was Isabel.
How did you end up spending time?
Well, because I was doing this documentary, which is still not seen the light of day, but maybe someday, on the history of the Yale
someday.
School of Drama, mm-hmm. and she was in the first class,
mm-hmm.
and she had this terrible lift like
interesting.
This, and she said, she wouldn't let us photograph her, but I recorded her, and I said, what was it like the first day of the Yale School of Drama? She said, it was crisp, with a crisp New England day, like a crisp apple. And she had this picture of this strange cartoon-like thing on the wall. And I said, is that Gertrude Stein and Alan Spitoklis in their dog basket? And she said, smart boy. And I said, what were they like?
That was your moment with her.
And
yeah.
I said, and she looked at me and she said, well, one of them was twice the size of the other. Summed up one of the great literary relationships
right?
of our time, of the last century.
Boiled down
to
right.
Right, and she called her brother, her late brother, Darling Thornton, and she had everything in the nursing home, in a room, and boxes and stuff, and all his papers,
oh, wow.
probably, which you ended up performing some of.
Well, yeah, some of them he had written over the course of 20 years or so, and And yeah, some of them were these fantastic little scenelets.
Which weren't
in their final draft form, but that he had put away. So to rediscover them, to put them up on a stage, another great experiment like this, a real experiment, and like, what could this be? What life does it have?
And yeah. Then you turned up in Next Fall on Broadway, which was the best play of last year.
It was last year, yeah.
Do you want to talk about that?
It was a fantastic experience. I got connected with it off-Broadway. I was an understudy for two of the roles, and it kept doing so well off-Broadway that some of the actors needed to jump out to do other projects. So I jumped in, and then when the producers brought it to Broadway, they brought everyone along, which was a wonderful thing.
Should we mention their names?
A wonderful
Thank
thing.
You. Very
for,
rarely
for
happens.
Actors.
Who were the producers that
Barbara
did?
Manicharian and Richard Willis.
Well,
Rich
thank
Willis.
You for
yeah.
doing that, because that was a wonderfully acted production. Oh, my
they
God,
were
that was so good.
I mean,
that
part
was
of,
the best play of the year.
Part of what made
Next
it
Next Fall.
So beautiful was the cast, who all were just superb in their roles. Made some, yeah, their indelible mark.
Like, I don't want to leave Clayton Apgar today at the Stephen Holt Show on location at the CSC. Is it Repertory Company? Is that the whole name, or is it just the CSC?
I think it's just Classic Stage
Classic
Company.
Stage
yeah.
Company. Mm-hmm. It's classic, and it's double falsehood. Is this you in the poster here?
No, we don't know who that.
We don't know who that might be. Shakespeare. We don't know. John Fletcher
John
and whoever.
Right. The both, yes, I think.
Brian Kulik right. when he was in his salad days. Maybe it was me. I don't know. But I feel this great deep connection, as all my viewers know, with Shakespeare. And I just saw a new play by Shakespeare. I got to go.
Well, thank you for coming.
And then
and coming back today.
Yeah, and then there you were, the lead in it, one of my favorite actors in New York, and I'm sure that just it's a matter of time before all of the world will know exactly who Clayton Apgar is.
Oh, well.
Thank you so much today for being on the Stephen Holt Show, Clayton.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. And have a fabulous.